think it's 6 o'clock, so we'll go live.
Sure. Yeah.
So welcome to this boardroom talk series, and it gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all today. Boardroom is a place where fortunes of great companies are written, and hence in the pursuit of bringing the best practices which the boardrooms have been following, the best practices which are followed by eminent directors, professionals who have been guiding and acting as torch bearers for the boards and the companies overall. So let me first introduce MentorMyBoard to you. MentorMyBoard is a up and running platform which is fully functional, where the corporate directors come together to learn, to network, to sharpen their boardroom skills. And we are on a mission to build a community of 1 lakh directors by 2027. Let me tell you, we have been doing lots and lots of programs for directors, which are very interactive. We have been conducting boardroom talk series. We have been conducting the directors roundtable, which happens every month. We also have been conducting the coffee meets for the directors, aspiring directors. So directors roundtables are usually focused on the promoter directors, the challenges which promoter directors, founder directors face in their day-to-day operations, and how at the board level the decisions can change. And it's again, the journey at the top is lonely. So therefore you need a right mentoring, right hand-holding. So that's what has been MentorMyBoard up to. And let me thank all our viewers for liking, sharing Boardroom Talk series, which happens every Friday. We invite eminent personality from the boardrooms, from Indian corporate boardrooms, as well as international boardrooms. So please keep liking, sharing, subscribing to the MentorMyBoard's YouTube channel, LinkedIn page, even Facebook page of MentorMyBoard. And most importantly, join the community of Circle of Directors on the MentorMyBoard page, which is very, very exclusive for directors, aspiring directors, professionals, promoter directors, startup directors, independent directors, and women directors. Today, I, CS Divya Momaya, founder of MentorMyBoard, invite our esteemed moderator, CS Bharti Iyer, who has reached 30 years of insurance industry experience, and she's been eminent advisor on the platform of MentorMyBoard. And let's get ready for today's boardroom talk with CA Kamlesh Vikamsi. And I request Bharti to introduce Kamlesh Bhai to all of us. And Kamlesh Bhai, thank you very much for accepting our invitation and
yes. With
all of us. Thank you. Thank you, Bharti.
Wonderful. Good evening. Thank you very much, Divya. And Kamlesh ji, thank you very, very much for accepting our invitation. It's our proud privilege to have you here on Boardroom Talk. I'm just briefly going through your profile. Kamlesh Vikamsi is a chartered accountant having more than 35 years of experience in public practice as a senior partner of Kimji, Kumarji and Company Chartered Accountants. He's a chairperson of the Audit Advisory Committee of the United Nations Children's Fund, UNICEF at New York. He's a chairperson of Independent Management Advisory Committee of the International Telecommunication Union, Geneva. Kamlesh is also a member of the Audit Committee of the World Meteorological Organization. Kamlesh has also served as a chairperson and member of the External Audit Committee of the International Monetary Fund, Washington, D.C., and is also on Audit Advisory Committee of the United Nations Development Program, UNDP, New York. He has also held the office of the President of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, New Delhi, which is a statutory body which is formed under the CA Act of 1949. Kamlesh ji was also the president of the Confederation of Asian and Pacific Accountants, CAPA, and has served as a member of the board of International Federation of Accountants, IFAC, in New York. He has also served on boards of several public companies, including general insurance, reinsurance companies, and has served as a committee member set up by the Government of India and various regulators. He was also on the steering committee member of the United Nations and has also recommended a comprehensive review of governance and oversight of the United Nations, the various funds maintained by it, and the programs and specialized agencies. Especially what I wanted to also mention was his deep interest with Vipassana, which has actually guided his life and supported him in a lot of ways. That is one. And also he has been very instrumental in creating centers of excellence, not only at the Chartered Accountants Institute, but also with Navneet Education. Welcome once again, Kamlesh ji. It's a wonderful honor to have you here. I just wanted to first go through the initial question which we had requested you. Before that, just quickly, your take on how Vipassana has helped you, how you got associated with it, how has it helped you in your corporate governance journey, and things along that trend first, please.
So thanks a lot for the wonderful introduction. And thank you very much, both Divya and Bharti, for inviting me today evening to share my thoughts on the platform Mentor My Board. It's a wonderful initiative which Divya, you have taken. Mentor My Board will be a very useful platform for the upcoming directors, and even for people like me who are experienced directors who have sat on the boards for now decades, to learn and to share experiences. And it's always through experiences that one builds and and one can really nurture the newer talent which is coming into the boardrooms of companies. So thank you very much. And by the way, even I learned my through my journey when I was young, when my seniors coached me and helped me in my journey as first of all, of course, the council member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. Thereafter, I became the vice president, president, and of course, thereafter, I've engaged in a lot of bodies where one learns from other seniors, juniors, both alike. Now, coming to your question, Bharti, on Vipassana, the seed of Vipassana was sown by my father. My father was a very spiritual man, but he didn't believe in rituals and going to temples and those kind of issues. But he was a true Gandhian. He wore khadi clothes right till the end, till his death. And a very, very righteous man. He was a role model for us. I mean, for me particularly, and for all my brothers and sisters. And he, in his journey of spiritual upliftment, came across Vipassana meditation. He went to a course at Igatpuri in the year 1981. And no sooner he came back from there, he immediately prompted me. I was 21 years old then. In 1981, he said, "No, nothing doing. You please go and take a course." That's how my journey in Vipassana started. And just to cut the long story short, the benefits of Vipassana are manifold. It basically teaches you how to not react, and that's what is essential in life, even in boardrooms and, even in your family life and other places as well.
Anywhere.
Absolutely. So that's what Vipassana teaches. And that has really helped me not only in my family life, but also in public life, where I go to the institute. And let me, in the institute, it's a big council of, that time 30 people. Now there are 40 people in the council. And there are all kinds of views expressed by different councils. Members who come from across the country, who as president have to really steer the entire discussion in a holistic manner. And it's very difficult because all are learned people, chartered accountants, who who come through the route of elections, so they are quite grounded, if I may say so.
Correct.
At that time, people used to comment that there were a lot of, even negative thoughts which come into on the table, round the table, which is quite natural. I mean, I don't blame anybody. I was wonderstruck that how you are so, don't you react to things? Training of Vipassana. That how not to react, be calm, absorb everything, and then, take a view. So that has really helped me, not only in my journey, but even in my board positions, in my international organization positions where I go.
Yes.
To listen to people very calmly, understand what they are trying to say. There's always a different point of view which you accept. And thereafter, put across your views in a very, very, so that's what I have been doing throughout my life in various positions I've held, board positions as well as other positions. That's the short answer to, why Vipassana and how I got into Vipassana.
Yeah, it's actually a very illuminating answer, because a lot of us have had people guide us. But, when we need it, we are not exposed to it. And by the time we get exposed to our spiritual search, it might be too late. So I'm so glad that you were, very initially 21 years itself exposed to this and you seized onto it. And it has been steadfastly holding you, throughout. Wonderful. Being a director and advisor on eminent international organizations representing India at these fora like IMF, UNDP, EAC, the World Meteorological Organization, we want to hear your views on the prominence given to audit and oversight at these organizations, the thrust and the focus on raising the bar of corporate governance. And you have any anecdotes, please do share with us.
Certainly. So basically, governance is one and the same, whether you sit on the board, which is basically a listed company where profit is a motive, versus you sit on an international. Now, the bodies which I sit on, international bodies, they are all UN bodies. IMF, of course, not a UN body, but equally an international organization. They are not for profit. They're basically for humanitarian. For example, UNICEF is for children, the pregnant mothers, the teenagers. So issues, concerning them. Equally, IMF was basically to pull out countries who have balance of payment problems, etc.
Correct.
Again, a body which looks into the climate change and, the climatic conditions which happen and how to predict them, how to safeguard people, destruction, loss, etc.
Okay.
EU, for that matter, is a technical organization on ICT, which lays down standards for spectrums. They lay down standard for satellites which go into the orbit.
Okay.
Global organization, but they are all not-for-profit organizations. Having said that, the principles of governance remain absolutely the same. No matter whether you sit in a small office, like in my own private office, public is what I do. The principles are exactly the same, whether I sit there or I sit on the board of a company, which is a listed company, or I sit on the international organization. It's all basically how do you handle stakeholders' interest, see to it that there are no conflicts, and you work for all the stakeholders. It's not necessarily you work for a set of stakeholders. In international,
correct.
Say UNICEF, which is for the children.
Yes.
And they have a very large program of distributing COVID vaccines across the world.
Mm.
To the least developed countries, which African continent and other places.
Correct.
Now there, you see, essentially the role of the audit committee and governance oversight is to see to it that, number one, controls are in place, are not misused, because ultimately the donors who are donating, there's somebody who gives the money, the country.
Correct, absolutely.
NGOs who give the money. So not, wasted, but they are spent for the intentions for what they were given. So every penny which is given have the intended purpose. So that's the whole purpose. So it's basically, so what value we add as an audit committee in those organizations, question the management. When I say question, I mean we are skeptical, but at the same time we are positive as well. That is one thing which I wanted to upfront bring it to the this audience as well, that on the board position as an independent director does not mean that you are a gatekeeper.
Correct. I've
heard several people keep on commenting that you're a gatekeeper, so see that, compliance are done and no violation, there's that. Of course, those are your part of your duties.
Yeah.
At the same time, you're there to add value to the company.
Yes.
Whatever is the skill set of each person, like I have, for example, finance background, I can look at internal controls, I can look at, those kind of issues. That's where I must add value to the organization which I go to. So those are, And coming to, say, board position, you said, share my experience. A very classic, example of experience which I've lived through.
Mm.
I joined the board of Centurion Bank, the erstwhile Centurion Bank, in the year 2000, somewhere in early 2000s, where I was taken at the behest of the Reserve Bank of India on the board, but of course as independent director, not as a nominee director of the Reserve Bank of India. As a chartered accountant, they said, you please join the board.
Okay.
And there were some financial, improprieties going on in the bank to take care of those financial improprieties. So as soon as I joined the board, of course, I told the chairman that, look, if I join the board, I want the balance sheet to be absolutely clean. And the chairman, who also happened to be retired director of State Bank of India, he was with me. He's Janki Raman. He was with me. He said, yeah, absolutely. So take your own stand. So the first year we wrote down all the issues which we had an accounting problem and losses, and our capital adequacy ratio went down to 3. Now in a bank, the general capital ratio is 9. And mind you, the Reserve Bank of India, on the same day as the board meeting for adopting the accounts, appreciated us, saying that we appreciate the Centurion Bank board.
Wow.
Come clean and has cleaned the balance sheet completely with us. Thereafter, that bank, we run that bank for 2 years. And of course, there was a promoter called Dev Ahuja who had floated the Centurion Bank, whose shares were, kept with Centurion Bank as a guarantee in case there was some problem. So we had taken those shares, we sold those shares and appropriated money of Centurion Bank.
Correct.
So there was no promoter as such of that bank.
Okay.
We were a board-driven bank. And what we decided was that we will add value to the shareholders. What happened thereafter was that for 2 years, we couldn't get a suitor. We offered the existing, there were two sets of shareholders, Asian Development Bank and Keppel Bank of Singapore. They were shareholders in the Centurion Bank, but they didn't come forward to, take over as promoter. And therefore, we run the bank for 2 years. In fact, we were given feelers from the Reserve Bank of India also to merge with a public sector bank at 10 paisa valuation, which we as board refused completely. We said, nothing doing. We will turn it around. And as history went, we got Rana Talwar, not Mr. Rana Kapoor of Yes Bank, but Rana Talwar, former state Standard Chartered CEO, worldwide CEO.
Correct.
Got him. He put in money into the bank. Bank Muscat, we merged Bank Muscat, we merged Bank of Punjab, we merged Bank Lord Krishna Bank with us.
Yes.
And we finally got merged into HDFC Bank.
Bank, okay.
See the consolidation of banking, what the government keeps on talking and they're
talking about,
is what we did long back. Those are the examples which I can put across in case of what value one can add as a board to the enterprise. We were supposed to sink, and in fact, I can quote and freely say that our competitor banks used to keep going to our depositors and said, look, this bank will sink. The capital was 3%, withdraw your deposit and do so. There could have been a run on the bank. Touchwood, fortunately, we had a very good board, a very eminent board. Former Controller Auditor General of India was also put on the board. We had bankers who were very experienced bankers, and it was a fantastic board. And we could turn around the entire. So what good governance can do to an entity, this is a classic example which I can,
Classic example, absolutely. Yeah. So it's not being a, oversight does not mean, auditing oneself and finding fault with oneself, but actually, as a collective team, triumphing over all these type of tribulations. Understood. It's actually a very well, an enriching example. So like I said, you have been a guiding force. So this is an example of being a guiding force. But as the president of ICI in establishing centers of excellence in schools also, like Navneet, in your opinion, is good governance a principle or a lifestyle which may be inculcated into childhood education so that one grows into excellence of governance and accountability? Ethics values are better imbibed at a younger age. We would like you to discuss this vis-a-vis Mentor My Board as a potential center for excellence in imbibing the higher levels of great governance in aspiring directors and young boards which are coming up.
So Bharti, you have raised a very important point, which is dear, very dear to my heart.
Wonderful.
Whatever you do from the childhood.
Yes.
Is what your childhood is. So that's the person you become. So your parents, your teachers, your peers, and the entire environment which you have during your childhood makes you whatever person you are, good, bad. I'm not commenting on that. But so essentially, you have touched your nail at the head, that if you start from childhood,
correct,
the principles of good governance, and in a very simple, easy way, if you teach the children, the society would be completely different. And I'm sure, you know, what we were today, and I see my daughter, I have a young daughter.
Correct.
Yes, in the 9th standard, she's a 15-year-old child. From what we were at that age and what she is today.
Correct.
And if you inculcate these, you know, qualities in a person in childhood, that remains forever, you know. So you hit at the nail, absolutely at the nail, that start early, even in school days, you know, teach the principles of governance, not necessarily corporate governance or, you know, those high funda things, but teach the basic principles about, you know, righteousness, what is wrong, how to balance, you know, the interests in life, because they also, you know, are always saddled. Even as a child, we are saddled with various, you know, how do you handle those conflicts?
Correct. How do you handle it?
If you start imbibing in them at the childhood.
Correct.
Start discussing with them. Like I discuss business with my daughter.
Daughter.
Mm. Subjects of business, economics, and those kind of issues. So I discuss current issues with her. You know, raises this entire issue about what is right, what is wrong, you know, how one should think. So the seeds sown early are always, you know, definitely helpful. And of course, mentor my board, the work is definitely, you know, in the right direction. You know, if you get people to share their experiences on your platform, be a good repository of good practices across, which would, you know, incentivize, or which would really, you know, people who are coming into the profession now, into the
correct
position or whatever position they sit on. So this is definitely a very, very good exercise which you have taken up. And I, you know, really make it, you know, big scale and train the board members. And I would also add that, you know, you need to train even the management as well, not necessarily the board members, because these are different aspects of governance. You know, you have the board, you have the shareholders, you have the management, you have the leaders, you have the suppliers. You know, try and bring out all the, you know, interests of all those, and there are always conflicting interests, and how to iron out conflicts of interest is part of good governance.
Good governance, yeah.
That's what,
Divya. That I would like to ask, you know, a very related question. As you said, nurturing the talent or the people right from the young age. Now, when I see a corporate, the startup is the young form of a corporate. I mean, even Infosys was a startup at one moment of time. So what one piece of advice you would give to the startups today, the founders of those startups today? There is a game of valuation. There is a race of valuation, which I see, you know, at sometimes in that race, the governance or the better practices take a seat back.
Yeah. So
what would you advise to young startups today who are at a very nascent stage of their corporate journey? And I think that's where, if they have a better practice or better practices imbibed in their top management that's at the board, how different that can be. And I know while discussing, you had mentioned that you have nurtured a lot of companies from very small scale to very large scale. So can you elaborate on that journey and some of your, you know, advice to the startups today?
No, it's an excellent question, Divya. And mind you have to start, the principle of governance remains the same, no matter whether you're a sole proprietor, your own interest, you know, there also conflicts come about. You know, you have to balance the interest of society, you have to pay your taxes. So those are the things which, you know, iron out. If you are a sole proprietor, where you are taking the risk, you're putting in your money, there's no bank money, nothing. Be it a small scale, you know, small and medium enterprise or a startup, exactly the same. You know, when you're small and young, imbibe these qualities of good governance. And when I say good governance, it does not mean that you ape and copy the big. And that's one thing which I've been, you know, sharing with the small and medium enterprises right throughout. And I share it even with international organizations. And to give you an example, in UN, you know, there are various kinds of bodies. There are, like, UNICEF is a body where $5 billion each year pass to UNICEF for the benefit of children, the pregnant mothers, this, that, and all. So that's one kind of an institution. And they do $3 billion worth of procurement. they procure vaccines. So all the smallpox and polio vaccines and all come through UNICEF. They are all distributed across the world through UNICEF. They do a lot of procurement, you know, 3 billion worth of procurement. I sit on the another similar body of United Nations ITU, International Telecommunication Union, which is a relatively smaller body, having a budget of, say, $80 million, a technical body, having only one office, big office in Geneva, where 300 foreign people sit and they work, and it's a technical body. It's not a humanitarian body. UNICEF, on the other hand, is in 180 countries, spread across, completely decentralized body. So question came before, say, the ITU, that, you know, procurement, for example. So you should have control. So what the question which immediately springs up is that, oh, what the other bodies are doing. So pick up from UNICEF, pick up from UNDP, you know, which are large bodies, and ape it over there. To which we as audit committee, and I particularly feel that you should not ape. What your circumstances are. And what the circumstances of that ITU was, that it used to only procure, say, computers, IT equipments, and all were involved. You don't need that extensive procurement kind of, you know, controls which are put in place, say, in terms of UNICEF. You need all the checks and balances. And including the checks and balances of, to the extent where I had raised one issue, procurement of vaccines. So UNICEF, for that matter, is about 80 to 90% of the vaccines across the world by UNICEF. They are manufactured by few manufacturers and the procurement takes place. So who discovers the price? Again, that's a very big issue, you know, which bothers my mind, that UNICEF is actually procuring. So what's the price discovery?
Correct.
Because there could be a problem in that, you know, if, and then fraud as well. You procure at a, you know, higher rate. So those are the issues which, you know, one should really, you know, look at, and which we should question. Coming back to Divya, your question about mentoring the small and medium enterprises. Small and medium enterprise, no matter whether they want to go public or not, whether they want to take bank borrowings or not, the principles of governance. So A, number one, ethical conduct. Number two, looking at the interest of all the stakeholders. Is something which, and especially I would advise, very strongly advise small and medium enterprises to have some experienced, you know, people who have really served on the boards of companies.
Okay.
These are the people who can really hold hand. Because many times the youngsters may not even know what is the importance of, you know, supposing you say that put in place a particular area of business. They may not understand why. And therefore, handholding of such, you know, small and medium enterprises is extremely important. And I may also add that if, you know, proper governance, if the seeds of proper governance are sown right at the beginning, no matter whether they go public or not, is immaterial.
All right.
Go and thrive. Therefore, the principles of governance are, you know, universal. And not only business, but it applies to your family as well. You know,
yes.
Family as well, your relationships, how you conduct yourself. Governance, what else it is? So I would, you know, strongly advise small and medium enterprises, be it sole proprietor, be it startup, techno, you know, technology companies, whatever. You know, when you start, please start on a clean slate and start on a, you know, ethical platform. And build over it. And in the short run, you may feel, you know, that it's not working for you. But I'm sure once you see in the long run, rich dividends, and your organization will also thrive, and all the people associated with your organization will thrive. My strong advice to startups and small and medium enterprises.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah, sir. In this journey, I mean, if you can, without mentioning the names. Actually, you know, think of a company which you feel has done very differently when it was a small, and that one thing helped them to grow faster. So maybe kind of the way you said good governance, but how do you define good governance? you know, for a smaller company, I mean, when we say two directors, two shareholders, I am the director, I am the shareholder. So how do you really at that age define the good governance for a company?
I can even name the company.
Yeah.
Let me name the company as well. I'm on the board of Navneet Education Limited, which is a listed entity. I joined this board in 1992 when there was no concept of independent directors and there were no directors, outside directors sitting on the board of companies.
Correct.
You know, companies were all basically the promoters and some friends of promoters or some relatives of promoters who used to be on the board.
Right.
He invited me to come on the board of. At that time, that company was merely doing paper trading.
Okay.
So the house, the Navneet house, was doing publishing of educational material and, you know, was educational. But they were all in partnerships. The copyrights were in partnership. Everything was in partnership, privately held. Paper trading, nothing else. So what we brought on the table as a board was that, look, let's put everything in this company. So what we did was that we, brands, copyrights, royalties, everything we transferred to Navneet Education at 1 rupee.
Okay.
Just 1 rupee. Though it was valued even then in those good old days, it was a huge value. You know, the brand had a huge value. Navneet brand itself had a huge value. But it was transferred at 1 rupee. Thereafter, you know, we brought in various aspects of, and we grew also in the line in which we were. And we brought in slowly all the businesses which were done in the partnership forms. They were all, you know, gradually wound up. Everything was brought into this company. And you know what it is today. And I can even share with you a data point as well, that in 90s, somewhere in 90s, the company had come out with the right issue. And my family, we had subscribed to some shares of those right issue as well. That company has given compounded growth. I'm saying compounded growth from 90s, 20%, more than 20%, which is a huge return. You show me one company, you know, which has compounded over a period of, say, long period of 2 decades at 20% compounded rate of interest. You will find none. So that's the kind of value we can, you know, add by, and it was very small when we started. Extremely small company where it was nothing, you know, that company had nothing. Because of good governance, we added good people in the board, we, you know, added good management. The management also, unfortunately for the board, the promoters were very understanding. And there were 3 generations of people, you know, family.
Mm.
Family, it's a large family of promoters, joint family, where there were 3 generations of people in the board. And in the management as well. Fortunately, they listened to our advice. They acted on our advice. And they've strictly followed what we said, which has given rich dividends. You know, the market.
Wonderful.
And it's a phenomenal amount of dividend. The payout ratio each year is more than 40% of the profits. So that's the kind of, you know, so that's a real life example I have myself experienced in my own career. In sitting on boards, how you know you can turn around a
small company to a big company.
Absolutely.
So in fact, the statistics, let me share with the viewers also, which I recently, you know, came out with. There are more than six crore businesses or SMEs, MSMEs listed, you know, registered in India, registered and unregistered both. And out of that, hardly 13 lakh businesses are registered as the corporate entity on the registrar of companies. And out of that, only 8,000 to 10,000 companies are listed on the exchanges. So the ratio is so less. I would like to, you know, just have your feedback that, you know, when we talk of the wealth creation, do you think getting listed on the exchange is the only way to create wealth, or, you know, any views? Because you, as you mentioned about Navneet's journey from being a partnership, kind of a very close family business, to today a very listed entity, and, you know, giving such a wonderful return to all stakeholders. So, you know, if you can throw some light on the benefit of getting listed, yeah, you know, it's okay to remain at a smaller. Because if I see the India story today, we are at the beginning of a new decade, and where I think India is going to write a very different story in this 10 years down the line. So what would be your piece of advice for the small businesses that, you know, should they get listed or go listed or remain there where they are?
No, so growth is a way of life. That's goes without saying. Whether to get listed or not is another ballgame altogether. But growth is, of course, so no matter whether you've started very small with one employee or yourself as a sole proprietor and, you know, your journey, but you should keep on constantly innovating and growing your business, which is completely, you know, a way of life. And that's how, you know, India will grow. As you very rightly said, this is the next decade will show exponential growth of the economy of India, where each one of us will participate, whether we are a small business or we are a very large enterprise, which is a listed enterprise.
Wonderful.
Coming to the philosophy of listing, definitely it unlocks value. There's no doubt about it. But at the same time, you know, do you require capital is something which a business or an entity would always ask. So that is a question which I ask in every board as well. Suppose a company has large amount of, say, cash lying in the balance sheet. What are you doing with that cash? Is it good for you to continue with that cash? What, I mean, will you be able to fetch? Will you be able to earn on that cash which you're sitting on the company, which is much better than what the shareholder will earn if you don't decide, or vice versa? So similarly, when you're a small enterprise, a listing or not is a factor of requirement of capital. If you do need capital, and if there are no other ways or means of get capital, listing is a very good option which one must look at. And ultimately, for every business, but of course, you should have management bandwidth. You should have the management bandwidth to grow and sustain that growth for a long period of time. That's when, you know, you need to look at, if you're a successful model of building a team, sustaining team, which can continue the growth, then yes, certainly listing is an option for you. Not an option for you. Because if you're contented and if you say that, no, I will remain a 10 people company, 20 people company, 30 people company, then listing is not for you. You as whatever entity you're running, but keep growing in that and keep prospering in that. So, I mean, coming to your, question, Divya, certainly there are businesses which scale up and which do need more and more capital.
Yes.
Listing is an option. There's one more option which has come is SPAC, which is a listing, you know, the recent example is Renew. It's actually merged into a NYSE company and has gone listed abroad
in
the US. So that's another way of raising capital, where you get a valuation as well. And, that's the, you know, sum and substance of what I wanted to add. But again, at the same time, when you're listing, you must understand, promoter must understand that there is a dilution.
Yes.
Your stake dilutes. So are you prepared for the dilution? How much you dilute? Those are very important questions which one must ask oneself before one actually does the listing. But, and once you do a listing, there's no going back. You can't do a U-turn and come back. So once you're going in listing, you have to go in that direction.
Very nice, this thing. Yeah, actually, Divya, it's a wonderful question as compared to the last director's roundtable, where we were talking about this very same. So we'll just come back to the various questions which I sent to you, Kamlesh Ji. The next one was regarding the pandemic, the resulting crisis, and the calamity-like economic climate. Now, in your opinion, how high should risk management, compliance, business continuity planning figure in every board meeting and agenda? What do you feel is the status of that agenda item right now? And how high do you feel it should figure going forward?
Most important. And to tell you very honestly, the moment lockdown was announced in the month of March, all the companies on which I was sitting, one question which I asked is that if your revenues become zero, you know, there's no turnover at all. And if you have to sustain your business, you have to continue with your employees, you have to with all your fixed expenses, what you're incurring, how much cash do you have in your balance sheet, which will sustain you over a period of time? Because that's the most critical thing.
Correct.
The second thing which I requested of companies was that please prepare a cash flow. Very, very, because the times have changed. Normally, I would not have asked these questions in a board. But during those challenging times, I said, you please prepare a detailed cash flow statement of how you're going to, get the cash from and from where are you going to deploy the cash. Because at that time, cash was the most important thing.
Correct.
People who are, facing bankruptcy.
Yes.
But, if you don't have money to pay and, creditors would come and knock your doors and you have to sustain the employees and costs, etc., the businesses would go bankrupt. Risk management, most important. But what I don't like of risk management is also what I would like to share with you.
All right.
Risk management should not become a ritual.
Hmm.
I think what generally happens in a board, and I desist that, and I not only in the board, even international bodies, I mentioned this in IMF as well.
Yes.
IMF is, one of the best institutions in the world.
Correct.
As credit is concerned, they have no countries have ever defaulted. Their money has never been lost, though they're into the credit business. They lend money to countries. Of course, they have their own safety valves and all that.
Correct.
Looking at that, again, risk management, a risk register, which is a word which I don't like. You make a risk register, put it on the shelf, gathers dust.
Correct.
So it's only for the sake of board that you come and tell us that, this is risk management, A risk, B risk, C risk, and we are addressing like this. No, that's not risk management. That's a ritual which you're doing.
Correct.
Risk management should be imbibed into each and every employee of the company right at the junior most level.
Correct.
Most junior most employee of the company. But own work plan, you must have risk management, in your work culture. Importance of risk management. And you also raised very important points on, say, business continuity. Here example where, business continuity of companies were tested in reality. Because that was a time when everybody was locked down to their homes and say, now run your
Correct.
Business. Do compliances, run your business, do sales, recover money, do this, do that. So
correct.
Real test of BCP, what we call business continuity plan.
Planning.
Most important, one very important risk is, threatening everybody, not only companies, but everybody is cybersecurity.
Yes.
That is a very essential part of, it should be at the top of the mind of every board. Maybe not every board meeting, but it should be discussed very, very thoroughly. And big advantage of discussing in the board. I also insist, boards I sit on, that please bring your second line management also and let them sit in the board. Potential thing we are discussing in the board, bring them and let them sit. Because they are the future leaders. Succession is also very important. And if you make them sit, what happens is that they get attuned to what questions the board members are asking.
Okay.
Therefore, that brings in the culture. So coming back to your question, that risk management, most important in your organization, how to address risks and how to manage risks. And in every situation, in any given situation, and I can give an example of a company where I sat on, this is much before pandemic, nothing to do with risk management.
Right.
There was a company, I would not like to name that company, but I was sitting on the board of an infrastructure company who had political problems as well. I'm sure you understand when I say political problems, what does it mean? They had problem from bankers, were right up to the brim that they could not take any further money. Getting to the equity market and raising equity. Projects were, infrastructure projects, what they were doing with the government. And what the government, how the government works.
Yes.
The payments and all that always delayed. There are disputes and arbitration and this and that and whatnot. But be that as it may, they were completely struck from all the sides.
Thanks.
So my advice to the board was that, look, please monetize your assets. You have some very good assets. They had some road assets, which was making huge amount of money.
All right.
Monetize those. Because all your projects will remain incomplete.
Huh.
able to realize revenue, the government is not going to pay you. You will get into that trap, debt trap, and you will get into bankruptcy. So that's risk management ultimately. What do you do in a situation? So those are the kinds of, you know, advice which should keep coming in the board and
the board
so that it starts the promoter also thinking. Otherwise, generally what happens is that, the promoters, they have their own way of thinking. They can't think beyond, you know.
Beyond.
You have to give them some out-of-the-box thinking.
Absolutely.
Thinking on those lines and implement those.
Totally. That is the value of independent directors.
Absolutely. So we are not gatekeepers. Again, back to the point which I raised. What I don't like about, you know, whenever I used to attend trainings of independent directors, the only thing we were taught is company law. Please see no violation of this. Income tax, don't see violation of this. Don't see violation of this. If this thing happens, then you must do this. You must do that. I said, look, we are not here to do that. Of course, we are here to see that there are no laws which are violated. By all means, certainly. But what we are here is to add value from whatever skill sets we bring in. If I'm a scientist, I must bring in my science into the business. If I'm a chartered accountant, I must bring in my finance. If I'm a banker, I must bring in my own experience. If I'm a, say, company secretary, I must bring in my governance experience. So those are the kind of experiences you bring into the board. And that's how the board grows. And everybody grows.
Very well said. Extremely well said. Thank you so much. Because I'm in the insurance business for the last so many years, and we live with risk, you know. So risk is very close to my heart. Different types of risks. So I have always been talking to Divya that we have to do something on risk management. And I'm so glad to see that Divya is also doing it, because she's the chairperson of the risk management committee in one of the boards. So this is
May I share one idea, thought?
Yes, please.
You know, on Mentor My Board as well, if you can bring in some good people on risks, you know, who are experts on risks, how to look at risk, how to, you know, address risks, it'll be extremely important. And have different risks. So, I mean, one can really get into, like, banking as a different kind of credit risk. If you're, say, a chemical factory, I sit on a board of a chemical factory. So for me, the risk is that suppose tomorrow something happens to the plant and, you know, the surrounding something happens, and how do you mitigate that risk? So there are different kind of risks for, like, your risk is that suppose something, you know, catastrophe happens, then how do you address that risk? You know, businesses have different risks, and one has to really look at that landscape. And maybe a risk management is very important, and how, you know, make it into a, not a ritual, but a way of living, you know, a way of doing business, way of living, and culture in an organization.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
I would encourage.
Absolutely. So this independent directors, Divya, you had something to ask.
I was saying that I think when Kamlesh Bhai has given suggestion, none other than Kamlesh Bhai, you know, we'll start with him. And it would be really our pleasure to have you on the platform, you know, helping us to set up that kind of, you know, the initiative. So I'll be in touch with you. Thank you.
And this is unlocking value, Kamlesh Ji. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Value of Mentor My Board, you're unlocking it for us. Thank you. Independent directors, there was a recent news item that SEBI proposes to put in place dual level approval for independent directors' appointment and resignations. Rather than being intimidated by this, independent directors are feeling intimidated. Do you not feel that IDs and aspiring independent directors may view this as an opportunity for majority shareholders' overt support?
So I'm not privy to what is the thought process behind that, SEBI thought process. And I would not like to get into that, you know, thought process. I'm sure they must have thought it quite well before they brought in this proposal and this particular, you know, aspect of governance. What perhaps the SEBI has felt, and I'm saying perhaps, again, I'm not privy to any information, that the independent directors which are being chosen, or rather picked, are picked by the promoters of their own, you know, from their friend circle or from their, you know, distant relatives or school friends or whatever, buddies, or, and that those independent directors are not adding value to the boards. And therefore, perhaps the thought process of that, apart from the fact that the majority of the directors vote for, or majority of the shareholders vote for the, you know, the election of a appointment of an independent director, there should be a separate voting even by the non-promoter directors.
Okay.
One will have to see how it works. I'm sure the, you know, and when we talk of non-promoter directors, what I would also urge is that the shareholder activism must be in our country, which is not the case.
Okay.
You know, what I observe is that the annual general meetings are not at all effective, because hardly there is any, you know, it's basically part of company law. One has to really, you know, get through. I'm not saying ritual, but one doesn't get too much value out of it.
Out of it.
The institutional investors, the qualified investors who are interested in the companies, they don't attend the AGMs and, you know, add value.
Okay.
Definitely attend the analyst call and they give whatever inputs are required to the businesses. So having said that, I think it's, you know, I mean, again, no idea why the thought process has come that, but if institutional investors play a larger role in voting for the independent directors, I'm sure the promoter directors would be in check and balance.
Correct.
Candidates. Put in the right kind of people the elections to the post of independent directors. You know, some people lose their election, say, in non-promoter voting. So that will, you know, again, it's democracy. So basically, I think the whole the background of the SEBI is that, you know, you should have right kind of people to manage the posts of independent directors who can really add value, who can, you know, who understand and who can add value. Say that I have even sat on companies where public sector companies where there are directors who don't add any value to the boards. I mean, I can understand they will not add value on, say, for example, financial numbers and all, because they're not qualified. By no means I feel that's the only skill which should be there. Not at all. But all right. At least add value to whatever skill set you have.
Correct.
Each individual has a skill set. It's not that people don't have a skill set.
Right.
Whatever skill set you have in the business, which you have joined. Otherwise, don't join that company. Because if you can't add value, there's no point in, you know, going and doing nothing. So that's my, you know, that's what I feel the regulator would have thought when they have brought in this proposal of dual election rather.
In fact, I'll tell you,
in September,
we had an independent directors summit, and one of the topic was the independent directors and promoter directors. So how do they, you know, actually both come together and add value to the company? And here, you know, I would like to say, I mean, when I was listening to those interactions, promoters are the best, I mean, because they have their stake involved very high in the company. They surely want, you know, the companies to grow. But again, role of independent directors is not only to be the watchdogs, but also to facilitate promoters to be in good governance. So I think, you know, if too much of regulations come in the appointment, in resignations, that will, I think, dilute the purpose. That's what I feel, you know, because promoters know who can be right. Yes, independent directors, database, examination, if a person is qualified, I think that all are good value additions. Too much of regulations coming in, appointment, resignations, I think, because as you rightly said, even I have observed, because being a company secretary, we help companies, you know, for holding the AGMs for so many companies. And I realized shareholders don't come up. Even to vote and attend in the meetings. So how, you know, that really is going to make any major difference. So here, rather than focusing on that, probably shareholder activism, helping investor education, awareness, that kind of initiatives, first they need to bring in, and then these kind of initiatives may be having, you know, a value addition.
Totally.
Over to you, Bhan.
Good thought, yes.
Yeah, so we are almost at the end and there's just 5 minutes more, but this is invaluable. Your advice is to mentor my board. 5 top topics for mentoring and coaching for young boards, nascent boards, as well as for aspiring directors.
So I think basically the whole, you know, attempt what you're making of people sharing experiences. So bring in experienced director and they can share their, you know, thoughts on and sharing anecdotes, as you rightly, you know, because they are real examples of what has happened. And they can, you know, really light to and could, you know, nurture the young talent which is coming. And I think this negativity about the independent director should be gatekeeper should go. Something which I don't like at all. Because you're not, I mean, I'm not sitting in the board just to, you know, be a gatekeeper and say that there's no violation of law, there's no this, there's no that.
Correct.
I mean, I would not like to join a board if I'm only supposed to do that. I want to join a board because I also want to learn. A number one, I want to add value.
Yes.
Things are doing, and you know, have satisfaction that part of a you know growth journey. Of maybe on those lines, I think if the mentor my board can, you know, start their programs.
Correct.
That really add value to people who you know join the various webinars and other conferences.
In fact, let me tell you, sir, exactly what you said. That was the thought process when we started this Boardroom Talk initiative.
Talk series, yeah.
I mean, till date, we have had close to 26 or 27 boardroom talks. And every boardroom talk, the person who came, the director or the, you know, the professionals who came on board to talk and share about their journey. I'm sure I have been, you know, getting so many responses from people when I, you know, talk to them. And there are, you know, few people who have been continuously watching these series. So that's where exactly, you know, the way you spoke about, you know, the SMEs, the listing, about, you know, the good governance. So those best practices sharing and is ultimately the object of this, you know, Boardroom Talk initiative. And I'll tell you the second, you know, the thought process behind this initiative was that when we see, you know, the directors or when we see the news, always the negative news comes up and then the directors are, you know, highlighted.
Correct.
Why not bring out the success stories of the how their directors have transformed the companies with their eminent presence, with their, you know, knowledge, with their, you know, that kind of commitment, what they have given to the boards, that should come to the public and that should come to limelight and that will really add value to the next generation. And
you know,
imbibing that kind of culture into the basically SMEs and startups was the process behind this kind of initiative.
No, precisely. I think you have hit, I mean, you've raised a very important point that what are the successful examples? Because those generally don't come out.
Correct.
They all remain within wraps. So bring out those so that, you know, people forget this corporate failures. And of course, that, I mean, not that the failures are also not good, corporate fraud failures. But there are several good examples as well where companies have really grown.
It's really been wonderful, Divya. I think that 7 o'clock and Kamlesh ji also just promised us that much time. So wonderful for me, you know, really insightful experiences you have shared, sir. Thank you so much. Really been wonderful.
And let me thank Kamlesh bhai for being here, you know, sparing your valuable time with all of us. And I'm sure, you know, the very important learnings, what you have shared about your journey in the boardrooms will help inspire and also act as a guideline, you know, for a lot of young entrepreneurs, young businesses and young professionals who aspire to be on the boards and of international companies, you know, the way your experience into the international organizations, even though those are, you know, the not-for-profit organizations, the government organizations, it's really, you know, very, very important. And I'm sure your guidance to Mentor My Board will keep, you know, coming. And I'm surely going to take a lot of your time, you know, especially 1 hour at least for understanding how, you know, we can really add value for the young generation. And thank you very much. So let me tell our audience here is that on 19th and 20th of March, we have a Boardroom Mastery Certification Program, which is happening. So this happens every 3 months. And the next session is going to happen in June. So make sure that if you want to know how the boards are run, how the very, very critical aspects of the boardrooms are handled and how the boardroom best practices can help your company to grow faster, ethically and manifold. So make sure that you are registering for this Boardroom Mastery Certification Program and get yourself certified, get yourself ready for the boardrooms. Whether you are a promoter director, whether you are an independent director, whether you are a women director or aspiring director, this Boardroom Mastery Certification is must for you to join and the be in the circle of directors. So stay tuned. We will be posting the link in the chat box as well. Thank you very much. And last but not the least, thank you Kamlesh Bhai again for being here with us. And thank you Bharti for, you know, always your presence for these boardroom talks. So thank you very much.
So thank you Bharti and Divya for this opportunity. And it was wonderful to you sharing my thoughts. Thank you.